Welcome to Learning English, a daily 30-minute program from the Voice of America. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Mario Ritter, Jr. This program is designed for English learners, so we speak a little slower and we use words and phrases especially written for people learning English.
On today's program, you will hear reports from Andrew Smith and Anna Mateo. Later, Bryan Lynn presents this week's technology report. Finally, we hear the lesson of the day from Andrew Smith and Jill Robbins. But first,
on the Indonesian island of Sulawesi, scientists have discovered the world's oldest known cave painting. The researchers used a laser to date the painting. They found it was created at least 51,200 years ago. The painting is inside a cave called Leang Karampuang in an area of South Sulawesi province. The scientists used the laser to date crystal structures of the mineral calcium carbonate that formed naturally on top of the painting. Maxime Aubert is an expert in archaeology at Griffith University in Australia. He was one of the leaders of the research published in the journal Nature. He said the new dating method is an improvement over other ways of dating rock paintings. The painting is a dark red color. It shows a pig that is 92 centimeters by 38 centimeters. Three human-like images are near the pig. The researchers think the painting is likely the oldest known evidence of storytelling in art. Griffith University archaeologist Adam Brum was another leader of the research team. He thinks the position of the human images near the pig gives the painting a feeling of action. There is something happening between these figures. A story is being told, he said. The researchers also used the laser to estimate the date from another cave painting on Sulawesi. That cave is called Leang Bulu Sipong 4. The painting in it shows part human, part animal figures hunting pigs and small buffalo. We, as humans, define ourselves as a species that tells stories, and these are the oldest evidence of us doing that, Aubert said. Little is known about the people who created the Sulawesi cave paintings. Aubert said the paintings might be older than the age found by the new testing. The paintings might date closer to the time humans first came to the area, around 65,000 years ago. Until now, the oldest known cave painting was from another cave in Sulawesi, from at least 45,500 years ago. The researchers said the Leang Karampuang painting is older than the cave paintings of Europe. The oldest known painting found in Europe is at El Castillo in Spain, dating to about 40,800 years ago. Before the discovery of cave paintings in South Sulawesi in 2014, some experts thought humans first created art in Europe. This discovery of very old cave art in Indonesia drives home the point that Europe was not the birthplace of cave art, Brum said. The earliest Sulawesi rock art is not simple, Ober added. It is quite advanced and shows the mental capacity of people at the time. I'm Andrew Smith.
It was a dream wedding in a lovely place, with beautiful clothing and a tasty wedding cake. This perfect wedding day in front of friends and family is for Bree and Bond, two golden retrievers. That's right, the bride and groom are dogs. Pet weddings are on the rise in China. This is happening in a fast-aging country where government policies have had little success in getting more humans to marry and have more children. The popularity of pets and a willingness to spend money on pet weddings are driving the increase. In China, spending on pets in 2023 rose 3.2% from a year earlier to $38.41 billion U.S. dollars. Bree's owner, Rai Ling, asked, "People have weddings. Why can't dogs have weddings?" Ling asked this after walking his pet down the aisle to exchange vows. The female bride promised to always share treats and play with the groom, Bond. The research firm, Acuity Knowledge Partners, said there were more than 116 million cats and dogs living in China's cities in 2023. That means about 1 in 8 Chinese people own a cat or a dog. And the majority of pet owners are under 40. Ling and his girlfriend, Gigi Chen, said they are in no hurry to get married themselves. However, that did not stop them from carefully planning their pet's marriage ceremony for months. They arranged for photographers, created made-up wedding certificates, and ordered a cake with a topper that looked just like Bree and Bond. Young Tao owns the Shanghai shop that made the cake. At first, she said she was surprised that people wanted wedding cakes for their dogs. "I think there will be more and more dog weddings," Young said. She added that she has already made cakes for several similar ceremonies since launching her shop in 2022. "We have already received an order for a few months from now, and that's for a dog wedding." Ling said he hoped the ceremony would give Bree and Bond a sense of ritual. Ling, who only wanted one child someday, said he hoped to welcome several puppies soon. I'm Anna Mateo.
The American Professional Racing Organization, NASCAR, recently rolled out its first electric vehicle model to the public. Officials with the motorsports company say they hope to use the vehicle to explore the level of interest in electric vehicles, EVs, among racing fans. Development of the car is also part of NASCAR's efforts to expand its overall sustainability efforts. NASCAR stands for the National Association for Stock Car Auto Racing. The company operates and supervises hundreds of races at numerous tracks across the United States, as well as events in Mexico, Canada, and Europe. NASCAR races involve stock cars. Stock cars are based on usual car models, but their design is improved for racing performance. The cars are stronger, more powerful, and specially fitted for operations on specialized, competitive racetracks. The organization demonstrated the new EV model last weekend in the state of Illinois at NASCAR's Chicago Street Race. So far, only one NASCAR driver, David Reagan, has driven the vehicle, worth $1.5 million. He has tested it on racetracks and also was behind the wheel in Chicago on Sunday. Reagan told reporters at the event that driving the EV provides a completely different experience for the driver. The vehicle does not have the same sounds and smells as gasoline-powered race cars. In those vehicles, the engine's sound, smell, and heat overpower a driver's senses. Reagan told local television station WGN about the EV driving experience. "Now you get to hear the brakes squealing and roaring getting into the corner. You get to hear the tires making noise across the corner," Reagan said. And, the racer noted, he suffered none of the ringing in the ears that comes with driving the loud, gas-powered cars. NASCAR engineers partnered on the vehicle with automakers Chevrolet, Ford, and Toyota, and electrical equipment company ABB. Europe-based ABB is currently NASCAR's official electrification partner. Company officials have said ABB aims to help NASCAR bring in more electricity from sustainable sources. As one part of its wider sustainability efforts, NASCAR plans to team up with ABB to help establish more charging stations for EV drivers attending races at its 15 U.S. tracks. NASCAR says longer-term plans include the use of sustainable racing fuel as well as recycling and using 100% renewable electricity at its events. The company also promises to cut its operating carbon output to net zero by 2035. Riley Nelson is NASCAR's head of sustainability. He told Reuters the organization has no immediate plans to start an EV racing series. Rather, the EV model was built as a demonstration vehicle to explore new technologies. Most NASCAR vehicles are based on normal sports models, but the new EV car is based on a larger crossover automobile. A large wing on the back of the vehicle is designed to help it compete with other race cars. NASCAR officials have said the vehicle was built to produce 1,000 kilowatts at top power. This is equal to 1,340 horsepower, about twice the amount produced by NASCAR's latest engine technologies. NASCAR is not the first motorsports organization to expand into electric car racing. Formula E is an international EV racing series that officially began 10 years ago. But that organization's fan base is much smaller than NASCAR's. NASCAR officials said demonstrating the EV vehicle at its events could increase interest in expanding the technology, especially among younger fans. John Probst is NASCAR's Senior Vice President and Chief Racing Development Officer. He told the Associated Press the technology might one day even help the group reinvent the whole fan experience. "It's our goal to entertain our fans," Probst said. "If our fans tell us this is what they want to see, we know how to create a racing series around pretty much anything." I'm Brian Lynn.
Bryan Lynn is here now to talk more about his technology report. Hi, Bryan. Thanks for being here.
Sure, Ashley. Glad to be here.
This week, you reported on a new electric car introduced by the motorsports organization NASCAR. We learned in the story that the production of this EV model was a cooperative effort involving several partners. What can you tell us about that?
Yes, so NASCAR says this development effort involved its own engineers as well as teams from American carmakers Chevrolet, Ford, and Toyota, and of course experts from ABB, the electrical equipment provider. This kind of collaboration involving different manufacturers might seem unusual, but it is actually quite common across racing. And in the case of the new EV model, NASCAR officials said it used the same teams to build that vehicle as the group's latest racers, which NASCAR calls its next-gen cars.
Your report also noted the Formula E organization, which has already been holding racing competitions for EVs for several years. Can we expect to see a similar competition launched by NASCAR?
This is certainly possible, but most industry experts think that if this happens, it will take a very long time. NASCAR itself is saying this is not one of its near-term goals for its competitions, but it has left the door open for it, and the group made it very clear that the introduction of this new EV is really designed to test how much interest there is in a high-performance electric car and whether it might be worth starting some kind of race, likely on a very small scale, to bring in even more fans who might have a real interest in paying to see these EV racers in action.
All right. Thanks again for being here, Brian.
You're welcome, Ashley. Thank you.
Welcome to the lesson of the day on the Learning English Podcast. My name is Andrew Smith.
And my name is Jill Robbins. Thanks for joining us. Today's lesson will help you learn more about the English you hear in our video series, Let's Learn English. The series shows Ana Mateo in her work and life in Washington, D.C. Here's Ana introducing herself.
Hello! My name is Ana Mateo.
Today's lesson talks about a special weather event, a blizzard. And our lesson will show how we use both the past perfect and the present perfect tenses when we talk about events.
Andrew, have you ever been in a blizzard?
I have, but it was a very long time ago. And I think we should explain what the word blizzard means.
Okay. A blizzard is a very strong snowstorm with a very strong wind. The wind blows the snow so much that it's difficult to see, and it can be dangerous to go outside.
Jill, I know that in January 2016, a strong blizzard hit Washington, D.C. Were you there, and did it affect you?
Yes, I was here. But I had fun. I had a niece visiting from Boston, where they usually have lots of snow. She was stuck with us for a few more days than she wanted to be. And that blizzard became the topic for Lesson 11 of Level 2 of Let's Learn English. The lesson is called The Big Snow. Let's listen to the beginning of the lesson. Kelly meets Anna, who is sitting and reading a book about the weather.
Hi, Anna. Why do you have all this weather stuff?
I love weather.
Me too. Weather is so important.
It is. It affects people's lives.
Have you ever reported on a big weather event?
I have. I've reported on a blizzard.
Do you mean the one last weekend?
Yes. I had been waiting for that blizzard for years. When it came, I was ready.
Many people, like Anna, get very excited about big weather events, such as blizzards. Anna also said that weather affects people's lives. And you might have noticed that I also asked Jill if the blizzard had affected her. Were you there, and did it affect you?
Let's talk about this verb, affect. It is spelled A-F-F-E-C-T. But even native speakers sometimes confuse this word with the noun, effect. That word is spelled E-F-F-E-C-T.
The confusion happens because we often pronounce the two words the same way. When we are speaking quickly, the first vowel of the noun, effect, is reduced to the quick sound, affect, which is the same sound as the verb.
Andrew, that's our old friend, the schwa.
Yes, it is.
It makes so much trouble for English learners. To affect is to create a change or make someone feel a certain way. And the noun, the effect, is the result of something.
How did the blizzard affect Anna? And what were the effects of the blizzard on Washington, D.C.? We're going to find out. But first, listen to Anna and Kelly again. And this time, listen for the present perfect and past perfect continuous tenses.
Have you ever reported on a big weather event?
I have. I've reported on a blizzard.
Do you mean the one last weekend?
Yes. I had been waiting for that blizzard for years. When it came, I was ready.
Kelly and Anna use the present perfect when they say,
have you ever reported on a big weather event?
I have. I've reported on a blizzard.
Anna uses the past perfect continuous when she says,
I had been waiting for that blizzard for years.
We use the present perfect tense to talk about an action in the past that is important in the present.
And what about the past perfect?
When one event in the past happens before another event in the past, we can use the past perfect tense to make this clear. We use the auxiliary verb had plus the past participle to show what happened first.
Before Anna reported on the blizzard, she had been waiting for a long time. Because waiting takes place over a period of time, we use the past participle been plus the ing form of the verb. This is called the past perfect continuous.
Now let's listen to more of the story about the blizzard. Anna got her friend Pete to help her do the news report on the blizzard. To do the report, they had to work on the weekend, and Anna brought supplies to help them.
Why am I here on a Saturday? Why are you carrying things? Why?
Pete, these are my supplies. Food, a blanket, warm clothing. Where are your supplies? Pete. This could be the blizzard of the century.
It'll be fine.
Pete brought almost no supplies with him. He didn't think the blizzard would have a big effect.
He was wrong. Let's listen to some of the effects of the blizzard and how it affected Anna and Pete. Anna continues to tell the story to Kelly. And be sure to listen for the present perfect and past perfect tenses.
The big snow broke all kinds of records, didn't it?
Yes, it did. And every time a record was broken, we celebrated.
So far in Washington, D.C., 29 inches of snow has fallen. That, my dear listeners, is a record! We just broke the wind speed record! Snow has been falling for 30 hours straight! That's another record!
By Saturday night, stores and restaurants had closed. Did you bring enough food?
I thought I had brought enough food, but I ran out. Hey, Pete, where's my bag of popcorn?
Maybe you ate it already?
No, I didn't.
I haven't seen it.
We had reported together for 48 hours straight.
Wow, that must have been a great team building exercise for you and Pete.
Yeah, you could say that.
At the end, Pete has eaten all of Anna's popcorn. Anna gets mad, and in the video, they start to fight.
So that's one way the blizzard affected them. And did you hear the other effects of the storm? The storm broke all kinds of records.
To break a record means to surpass. And that's spelled S-U-R-P-A-S-S, or go beyond what had ever been done before. For example, in 2009, Usain Bolt ran the 100-meter race in 9.58 seconds. That broke the world record and is the fastest any person has ever run that distance.
And the blizzard in D.C. broke records for the most snow that has ever fallen in D.C. 29 inches, which is almost 74 centimeters. And it broke the record for the longest amount of time snow has ever fallen in D.C., about 30 hours.
I remember I had a stick in my backyard to measure the snow that time. Those are still records for D.C., so we say the storm broke the record for the most snow that has ever fallen. We use the present perfect tense because we are connecting that past event to a record that still stands.
When we say a record still stands, we mean the record has never been broken.
Blizzards do affect a lot of things, especially in a city like Washington, D.C., which rarely gets them.
And even a little bit of snow can affect Washington, D.C. a lot.
You've been listening to the lesson of the day on the Learning English podcast. Thanks for listening. Remember that you can also find us on Facebook, Instagram, and YouTube. I'm Jill Robbins.
And I'm Andrew Smith.
And that's our program for today. Join us again tomorrow to keep learning English through stories from around the world. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Mario Ritter, Jr.